What's up, everybody? This is the Jedi. So, I call bullshit on this. And I'm going to tell you why. You all know that I'm not a hip-hop fan at all. In fact, I couldn't tell you a single song this brother did. But I know him because I've seen him on panels and symposiums giving his point of view. I did not know that he was as active as he was and rooted, so to speak, you know. I didn't know that. But here's the most important thing. Anytime you have anomalies, everybody, if you've not seen the 9/11 video that I did, it's here on the channel. I did a full documentary on 9/11. Over the course of that video is the result of 3 weeks of work. Like, I literally go through clothing changes in the video. But I bring that up now because one of my ongoing themes in that piece was to communicate to you that anytime you have anomalies, that's usually the stench of conspiracy, the footprint of conspiracy, an identifier. That's the first thing you look at when you have a big event. Is there any anomalies here? And an anomaly is something that otherwise just wouldn't happen. You go to Vegas, you are standing next to a slot machine, and you pull it and you win $1 million. That's an anomaly. Because it wouldn't normally happen. And more importantly, it normally wouldn't happen to you. So, we have to look at anomaly. I will tell you that on Sunday, when I heard this, it was like a flash on the news, you know, like coming up at 11 or something, I don't know. And I said, oh my God, not that brother. Not him. But I knew I was going to wait. Let me see. What are they saying? That was my first impression. Then when I heard the story of what happened, I wasn't satisfied. But I wasn't calling anything foul on it at that time. You know, I've lived in California. I know that area, you know. But you always look at any event, everybody, to who stands to gain. You go to rob a bank, people go into rob banks because they stand to gain money. For whatever reason, they're not there to hurt the bank. They need a coin. You have to look at motive and who benefits. I heard T.I. speaking very eloquently once again. That brother, I feel like we're related. But I heard him speaking, and his angle was, but I know how T.I. can be diplomatic. And what's the word I want here? I don't know the word, but I know how he can, I'll just say, play the game, you know, because this particular pronouncings from him were on TMZ to Harvey Levin, you know, and Charles, his little butt boy. So I could understand, you know, but T.I. was, and you know, you could be multi-layered. So he was attributing this to it being a situation, you know, he was describing how in our culture there is power. I'm paraphrasing his words now because it was a statement and then Harvey asked him about it. There can be power, and then there's people that don't want to see that because they don't have that. Basically, just haterades, you know what I'm saying? To put it in short terms for you. But his explanation was different than the written statement, everybody, is what I'm trying to communicate to you. Because I know that was to white people. That was to white people. And he just decided in the back of his Rolls Royce when he was Skyping into TMZ to use that as a moment to talk about the intercultural dynamic. But his statement stood out because I didn't know he was even going to speak. When they said, you know, we have a statement by T.I., and they read the statement first, I'm like, yeah, I already know. And they go, and we have T.I. now. I'm like, oh, okay. And then so Harvey, being the Zionist devil that he is, knows what that statement meant and who it was directed to, because they always get you on there and say, what did you mean by that? We've all heard this. We've all heard this. We've all heard this. Where a black person says something that doesn't come across all sugary and perfect and glorify white people, and then they want to get you on their media because they're insulted at the littlest thing, even a grain of rice. And then they go, it's a white media tactic. Would you read your statement and go, what'd you mean by that? What'd you mean by that? You see, it's this daring us. It's this daring us. I dare you. You know, like even in the face of police brutality, we're not even supposed to even contemplate violence and striking back. I reject that. You want something you never had, you gotta do shit you never did. Or you won't get shit else. Other than what you've ever had. So he changed it. He changed it. He changed it. You see? But for me, the first anomaly that jumped out is they said that the very next day, he was supposed to be meeting with the police commissioner to discuss gang violence and what they could do to quell it and bring the community together. You know, solutions. The next day? Now, so that statement there, I knew that first before I saw T.I. When they read T.I.'s statement and said that was T.I. saying, it could have been Moses saying, it didn't matter. That fit with that first thought that I had when they said he's supposed to be meeting the next day with the police commissioner about gang violence. That's your first anomaly. That's your first anomaly. Listen, no detective worth their salt would overlook a clue like that. Oh, a husband dies, and the very next day, he was supposed to testify against his wife in a murder case, and he was the star witness. Nobody would ever believe she didn't kill him, or at the very least, she's going to be dragged through hell before they decide she's not guilty or whatever. The very next day, he's supposed to meet with a white person or some black coon. I don't know who the police commissioner of Los Angeles is. And to discuss the very thing that gets him killed. Now, there's a little history. We know at least in 2014, there was a shots fired at his tour bus in Chicago. That stood out to me because y'all know I'm from Chicago. And the fact that he's a rapper, the fact that he's got tattoos everywhere, that wouldn't be a shock to me. Like, of course, people are going to be shooting at you. Of course. Of course. You see? Because nobody's shooting at Usher. You see? Nobody was shooting at Michael Jackson. Nobody's shooting at Celine Dion. Nobody was shooting at Whitney. You see, it's about how you carry yourself and where you're from, and then what you do once you become, you know? So a lot of these brothers never make the transition, you know? And I think he's the perfect example of that, only in this way. Like, he went in the right direction intentionally, and where he invested his money and the things he was trying to do for the community. But then, bro, you got to go all the way. You got to take the rags out your pocket. You got to take this bullshit off. You got to do something with them tattoos. You got to show a new way. A new way. Because for the young brothers coming up, they don't make the distinction. They think, oh, well, the person who works at McDonald's has a job and they got tattoos everywhere. This dude has tattoos everywhere and he's taken seriously, so I don't need to, I can just look like a savage and I'll be taken seriously. No, you won't. We ain't there yet. I look to a day and I'm willing to die for a day when we rule this bitch and you do what the fuck you want. You understand? But right now, we're at war. And when you present yourself a certain way, you're drawing incoming fire. You see, this is borne out by the facts. I tell you guys, go back as many years as you want and just look through the list of people who have been shot down in interviews by police. Find out how many of them sound like the name my mama gave me. That's an Arabic name. We don't have any Muslims. This isn't happening to us. We don't walk around looking like Nipsey Hussle. We don't. And when we have brothers that come to Islam that look like him, they do something different. I cite for you. I brought you the story of the rapper Loon, you know. The thing that I'm most familiar with him from is he did the rap on that free the freeway song that Toni Braxton did, you know. Dun 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 dun. I can't think of the damn tune. I don't know. Whatever. Hop the freeway, whatever. There's a rap. That's the rapper Loon. He is a Orthodox Muslim now. And remember, when we talk about Muslims, we're not talking about these Nation of Islam people. They are not Muslims. All right. We're talking about Orthodox Muslims. So I'm saying, like, you know, and I appreciate he's got a full man's beard. That I appreciate the brother for that. You know. So maybe there was some inspiration. Maybe some things were coming. I don't know. And I don't know his people, the circle of people that he knew and all these sort of things, you know. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. But so after I learned that he was supposed to be meeting with the police commissioner the very next day, that was my first anomaly. Then I saw some council coon who said which I had heard this in another report. I thought I heard it. Somebody said, but it wasn't the way they said it. It wasn't like they were stating this to be the topic of their statement. It was cursory to something else they were saying. So when I get something like that, I don't, then I just heard it. I store it, but that would be something I would follow up on. So I heard somebody say, and then he bought the block. And it was somebody white saying it, so I was over it. But now, then it turns out, I heard this coon council person saying that indeed he did own that he had bought the store and then acquired the land. So there's a T-Mobile there. There was oh my God, I should have got a picture of that. I don't remember everything that's in that plaza. I should get that picture. Damn it. I'm too lazy. I'm too fat and lazy. But what I'm saying is that mean those people would have been his tenants. You understand? And I was watching those aerial shots. That's a big piece of land, you know. And it's interesting too that they were calling it. I heard the term South Central Los Angeles being used at different times when many years ago, when they started trying to, because that's a choice piece of real estate, because if it's proximity to the beach and Beverly Hills and it's the proximity of this of South Central Los Angeles is a choice piece of real estate. Like that's been known for years. All right, so they started calling it South Los Angeles. You see, which just means white people are moving in somewhere. You know, this makes me sick. All right, but so I'm trying to put this in context because this black council person that I'm trying to mention now was saying that they've made plans because there's some subway or rail that's supposed to go right through there and stop right where his place was. And now we're gonna have to we'll make that a memorial to him, which my ears hear, you're seizing the land. You're seizing the land. Here's a brother that owned that store, but in every report, nobody was saying he owned this damn center. And he owned the land, that whole aerial thing you were seeing. And there may have been more, but he certainly owned all that, where the buildings were and the surrounding that island, so to speak. I don't know if that's a couple of acres. I don't know what that is. But they didn't mention that. You see, and then so when you by the time you get to the black coon, and he's saying, and so now since this project was already going forward, now we'll have to include, a memorial for him so people understand and have access to the culture and blah 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 and vomit, 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 and this was my second anomaly. This is an anomaly. This is an anomaly. It's an anomaly. Thirdly, when the white bitch jumped into the car with the brother in South Carolina the other day, and they've been holding vigils for her. I didn't see any police presence at all. I'm still looking for police presence at her at the bitch's vigil. Still looking. You see. But the moment I saw the police presence at this memorial, I said there's going to be problems, and it's going to be provoked by the police. That was my third anomaly. That's the third anomaly. That's my third anomaly. Do you understand me? Fourth anomaly. Lo and behold, they never catch anybody in black on black crime. Certainly not in South Central Los Angeles. How many murders are outstanding? Huh? Let's ask the white heifer. Let's ask her ass. How many unsolved murders of African Americans are unsolved in Los Angeles? The question was too much for her ass. She can't talk. She just got to throw it up for you and let you look at it. Here's a we'll just look at the first stat. While blacks account, this is from April of 2018. While blacks account for the majority of homicide victims. Wait, let me just hit this because. Oh, is this part of this? It's called Tragic Unsolved Inner City Murders. Okay, they're giving me. In the last 10 years, about 26,000 homicides committed in the United, I don't want the United States. I need Los Angeles. We got to be specific. Let me go on and make my statement. Because I don't need a number. I know I'm right. You see what I'm saying? So, what I was going to say to you is, show me now the number of unsolved homicides in Los Angeles where there is video evidence, video footage and everything, and we just don't have any suspects. We just don't. But within a 72-hour period, you had a name of a suspect. That's my fourth anomaly. My fifth anomaly is he happens to have the exact same name as the first black attorney general of the United States of America under the last administration, Eric Holder. That's my fifth anomaly. my fifth anomaly. So, as an African, I know this shit don't just happen. You understand? Then I was also deeply disturbed by the outpouring from whites. As if they were just so familiar and just knew him and just loved the work he was doing and they just could not go on without him. I'll just count that as a sixth anomaly just because I have to. Just because it made me sick. You know. And then sure enough, as I predicted, there was chaos at the vigil. 19 people, I think it said, were injured and 3 critically. You know, and they showed the images of people running and, you know, you heard some kind of glass or cracking or something that set it off and people start running. Because, you know, black folks won't stand around. We ask questions after we get to safety. Then we'll call you and ask you what happened. You see. But I had already foreseen that. Because I saw the police presence. This one, there was probably, you know, 50 people there, if that. You know, like, you know, it's a growing memorial, But I was looking at what is the white man doing, and what are they saying in this hour? What are they doing and saying? You see? Because they are the ones to watch, because all evil emanates from them, period. I didn't create it. You understand? But now, it's interesting to know, too, everybody, that his name was Ermius Askedom. That was his name. Ermius Askedom. You heard me saying in one of my recent videos, I'm so sick of brothers going by these stage names. There's way more depth to that brother's name than Nipsey Hussle. You understand? Which, by the way, he just changed an age because there's a famous comedian, I think he's already passed on, named Nipsey Russell. He was in The Wiz, I think, even. Played the Tin Man, I think. I don't remember. Anyways. But, again, this is like a little sidebar statement right here. I'm going to continue with the main topic. But I want to sidebar and say, I have more respect for Ermius Askedom and would probably bow before him when I met him than you tell me your name is Nipsey Hussle. It's not going to be the same respect level. It's just not. Because I just met some dude named T, and before that, I was another brother named DM or some bullshit or some, you just all these stage initials, and I can't. I let brothers know immediately when I meet them, I'm not going to remember your name. I'm not. I won't. Unless you'll give me the name your mama named you. But that was his name. Ermius Askedom. And it's Asghedom as in Mary. Beautiful name. Beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful. He's born August 15th, 1985. Known professionally as Nipsey Hussle. Was an American rapper and songwriter from Los Angeles, emerging from the West Coast hip-hop scene in the mid-2000s. Nipsey immediately became known for his numerous mixtapes, including his Bullets Ain't Got No Names series. Very ironic. Not so much, because when you're in that life, this doesn't become ironic. You know, like I seen them playing I don't know what I was watching. It was some murder show. And it was showing this dude that was supposed to have been the friend of the suspect. And it was a black dude. And they just showed a quick video of him. He was like, murder, murder, kill, kill, murder. I can't. And they never talking about killing the enemy of our people. That's what really kills me. That slays me. That slays me. You understand? Even the damn, if you believe this devilish-ass government, even the Arab countries that they attack proclaim death to America. They don't say death to their own damn country. You understand? Nah, you don't wish death on your own, you wish death on your enemies. You understand? Okay, and emerging from the Los Angeles, he initially became known for his numerous mixtapes, The Marathon Continues, and Crenshaw, the last of which rapper Jay-Z bought 100 copies of for $100 each. After much delay, his debut studio album, Victory Lap, was released in February of 2018. Interesting. Victory Lap. That's kind of prophetic. Was released in February of 2018 to critical acclaim and commercial success, and was nominated for the best rap album at the 61st Annual Grammy Awards in 2019. You know, it's too buttoned up, everybody, because again, as I say, and then I heard people pronouncing stuff that I know didn't come from black lips for the when it first started. I heard black people saying, you know, and let's not start with the conspiracy series. Let's give the family time to. Black folks don't give a damn on the timing of conspiracy because we sniff it at the minute one. And if it's there, we don't care when it happened. That's not no disrespect to the family at all. Because what happens? When something happens to anybody in your family, you want to know what happened immediately. But you can't tell me about conspiracies. I want to know what happened. Don't tell me about conspiracies. I want to know what happened. Don't tell me about conspiracy. No, come on. It's an oxymoron. It's a conflict. So I knew that. So I'm gonna title that my sixth anomaly, because that would not come off of black mouths. That would be recited by weak ass Christian-minded slaves. You see. So that's my sixth anomaly, or seven, or whatever I'm up to now. I think it's my sixth anomaly. But I believe then, here's the eighth anomaly, or the seventh one. Then we learn, listen, I'm itemizing these for you guys, because I always tell you about the big picture. One thing by itself, oh, the guy's name was Eric Holder. That's fine. What a coincidence. His name is the same name as the guy that was the attorney general, first black, you know. Oh, how nice. Oh, he was supposed to meet with the police the very next day. Oh, for gang violence and gun violence. Oh, you see, so this is why I'm itemizing these things. Here's our seventh anomaly. We learn that he was doing a documentary on the life and work of Dr. Sebi. Now, if this doesn't send you to the fifth store window, I don't know what will. Because we all knew that Dr. Sebi's death was and is still some bullshit. We know it. Just like it was with Left Eye. 'Cause she was getting way too spiritual for them. 'Cause it's the devil. Remember, separation of holiness and what we gonna do. You see, even though Christianity is some bullshit and it's a lie, those people, we want to keep that separate from what we do in our government. So separation of church and state. State will be run by the devil and be evil, and y'all do whatever y'all want out there. Until we need you for votes, and then we will bring you in under the auspices of prosperity campaigns and the bullshit to use the church. I'm over it. That's another video and I've done it. But I'm trying to say to you that Left Eye's energy, her vibration was too much for them. Too much. Too much. I instantly knew when this happened to her, something was off. You see. But then, Dr. Sebi. You know, he had been to court. If you don't know the story of Dr. Sebi, we've taken your black card and get your ass off the internet and go learn. You see what I'm saying? Or at least get off of YouTube and go learn on something else. Go learn. But he had been scandalized and marginalized. And to know that this brother took an interest in that brother said a lot to me about this brother. Because I did not know about that. That is glaring. That's glaring. That's glaring. Because when you talk about the obsession they have with trying to create this new interracial race, they're trying to make gay people a race of people. They're marketing all this interracial bullshit 24 hours a day. Appreciate Yara Shahidi for saying we don't integrate, we procreate. Appreciate that Black Panther fist in the air Afro wearing sister. Yes, Yara. Oh my God, I love that. That came out of nowhere. Like I didn't even see the NAACP awards, but I, you know, you've seen the highlights, the clips. And she was saying she stands with Jesse, and she said, she goes, and by the way, we don't integrate, we procreate. I'm like, yes, my sister, yes, yes, we don't integrate, goddammit, we procreate. You understand? I need a shirt that says that now, you know, because this plays into this narrative that I'm putting forth now with regard to this relationship between him doing this documentary on Dr. Sebi and then also and what the that would be a threat. Again, going back to T.I.'s statement, the written statement before Harvey goes, what do you mean by this? You see, that first original statement, that stands in my mind, period. Matter of fact, let me see if I can get you the quote for that, y'all. And I appreciate they had somebody down there saying these celebrities need to stop tweeting and come down here. You know, come down here. I appreciated that because, damn it, it's time. And where were they to swoop in and say, we will now take over the land here for Nipsey and make sure that it stays within his family and be, you know, administrators of it or whatever. You know, this was a financial grab from this brother back to the white devil. I suggest to you, it is also, we can't have peace amongst these gang members. Because then we can't justify the police in the schools. Because the Los Angeles Unified School District has some of the highest fucking numbers of police in schools and the highest numbers of random searches on students in the fucking country. That has implications for that. You're cutting into white money. You understand? So it was a grab. You see? It was also to probably try to stifle this documentary. But we understand that Nick Cannon's bubblegum-eating ass is vowed to pick it up and go on with it. We will be looking very, very closely to see if Nick follows through with that. You see, if he do that, I'm probably going to roll with him for a minute. But you want to show me, man. Like, I need you to do this. Because that will say something. Because we would then be looking to see, is Nick being asked to change anything? How many white hands are on it? Does it look like there's being something put in the way of it to try and stifle it and these sorts of things? You see what I'm saying? And this will prove our point out. Damn it. Okay, here it is. So he says, some people try to destroy you. Sometimes people try to destroy you. Precisely because they recognize your power, and he circles that. They recognize, it's underlined. See this, everybody? They recognize your power, and he circles it. T.I. is speaking to those who can hear. You understand? I was very clear about this. I didn't need nothing else. I didn't need him to be on camera. Fuck Harvey and his little butt boy, and I'm over it. Precisely because they recognize your power. Not because they don't see it, but because they see it. And they don't want it to exist. He is talking about white ass people. They are and always have been jealous, and their biggest fear is that we run shit. That's why their heads rolled off when Obama became president, because that's the ultimate power they thought we would never have. And damn it, a black man has risen to that, and we can't allow it. Because everything that we do, if we do it or get a chance to do it, whichever the case, we excel far and beyond over them. And they're the only people vexed with jealousy on the earth and obsessed with being number one and being in power and shit. Just them. Nobody else. Nobody. So this was clearly to African people, speaking about white people, and Harvey knew it. Dumbass sellout, mixed ass, whatever he is, Charles that sits next to him, who is not an African. Of course, I think it probably just went right past his fake ass locks. I'm over it. So for me, there's too many anomalies here for this to be random. And now we're understanding that the video is available. I saw at least one still shot picture that I wasn't able to find for you for this piece. And so, you know, but we do hear that there is, you know, they're giving us, there was a female driver. And it's, you know, the dude, and so, but Nipsey wasn't the only one shot. He's the only decedent. The other two people, as far as we know so far, have survived. Now, if we get any word that their condition has changed for the worse, then that's going to be another fucking anomaly. Do you understand? Because they can tell us from beginning to end. They can tell us what Nipsey was saying at his final moments, what happened, how it happened, everything. They are highly critical to this case. Do you understand what I'm telling you? And I suggest to you that we're being diverted away from them, because all the attention is supposed to go to everything but them, just to keep it short for you. You know, like, don't forget that they exist. Don't remember that they exist. Forget that. No. Throw that out. But I remind you, there are people in the hospital. You see? And we want to hear from them. We want to hear from them. Because they're extremely critical to us understanding the truth of what has happened here. You know? And we want to know more about this Eric Holder person. It's just some take the fall ass nigga that was in the hood that they've decided, you know, because like I say, it falls into my anomaly requisite that his name is Eric Holder. Like, I'm not ready for it. You know what I mean? Like, to me, that's not just random. That's not random. You know, now. USA Today says that this is, well, we'll get the most recent one. 29-year-old, police say the 29-year-old Eric Holder No. Police named suspect in Nipsey Hussle killing, 19 injured at rapper's vigil. Early Tuesday morning, the LAPD, lying ass police department, that's what that stands for, announced that it is seeking a suspect in the shooting death of rapper and entrepreneur Nipsey Hussle on Sunday afternoon. The police have identified the suspect as Eric Holder, a 29-year-old Los Angeles man. According to a police statement, it is believed that Holder walked up to three men in front of Marathon Clothing. The 33-year-old musician's store in Crenshaw, in the Crenshaw area of South Los Angeles. There's that phraseology, everybody. In the area of South Los Angeles, and fired numerous times at them. Holder then allegedly fled the shooting as the passenger in a white 2016 Chevy Cruze driven by an unidentified female. At a press conference held Tuesday morning, that included LA Mayor Eric Garcetti and lying-ass police department chief Michael Moore, Moore said that based on video evidence and witness statements, Holder allegedly spoke to Nipsey Hussle, left the area, and then came back with a gun. He added that the police believes, he added that the police believes, it says that, there was some kind of dispute between Nipsey Hussle and Holder, but declined to characterize the nature of the argument. Moore later said in answering a question from the media that the LAPD believes that Holder is a gang member, and Nipsey Hussle's past gang activity is known, but Moore declined to say that the killing was in any way gang related. You know, well, the Grammy nominated Nipsey Hussle, born Ermias Askadon, died from his wounds. A longtime community philanthropist and activist, he had been scheduled to meet Tuesday with LA Police Commissioner Steve Soboroff and Moore about ways to help stop gang violence. Quote, "I'm very sad," Soboroff wrote on Twitter. Nah, you're not. You're the devil. Meanwhile, there was a stampede at a memorial vigil held for Nipsey Monday evening. At the Tuesday press conference, Michael Moore said that someone in the crowd who was armed either brandished or displayed a gun, and that another person attempted to disarm him to protect the crowd. I'm over it. It didn't happen, everybody. Again, that's why. And when I kept watching that video and slowing it down, and there's white people in the crowd, they can't be allowed around us, whether they're in uniform or not. They can't. They can't. Listen, oh my God, there's a new series. I think it's on BET, everybody. I don't know what it's on. I don't even know. I can't remember. Anyway, it's called Finding Justice, I think. And there's these activist students. You know, this one girl, this one young sister, teenager, her name is Shay, I think. Oh my God, that girl is so impressive to me. Like, I need to know her personally and be friends with her. But they were teaching them some things about, you know, how to protest and how to do sit-ins and how to do things and da da da. And one of the things that they were saying, the Black Lives Matter chick didn't say, but this other dude that was there who happens to be an actor activist said, he goes, and know everybody around you. Know who they are. Anybody that doesn't belong, you make sure you basically, you know, blah, 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 blah. So it's like that. Like, they can't just be showing up. You feel me? Like, nah. You see, you got to sterilize the area. You feel me? You got to sterilize the area. And the only time I saw that was during Ferguson. And during that time, I'll say that, because I'm not sure if this actually happened in Ferguson, what I'm about to tell you. It was at that time. And there was some rally or something, some protest or something. And the sister got up on the stage and said, excuse me, all white people and all white media to the back. I brought you a video about that. You understand? Because that they understand. Look, you got to go. Don't give me, I'm a good one. You can't say all of them are bad. Well, get your bitch ass back, because we don't know. You understand? Oh my God, I can't. So, like I say, when I saw that, I knew there was going to be a problem. I knew it. Meanwhile, I'm sure the vigil for the heifer in South Carolina is still going on as I speak. No question. So this more posted on Twitter Monday night that 13 people sustained injuries, and as attendees fled, 12 were treated on site. Multiple news outlets later reported that, per the Los Angeles Fire Department, at least 19 people were injured. Most of those were injured by falls, sprains, and being cut by glass. Moore said that some in the crowd were throwing glass at the police. One person was reportedly stabbed. You see, because they were the fucking rebel rousers. If they weren't there, alhamdulillah. If they weren't there, first of all, I doubt anybody was throwing anything at the fucking police. This is the LAPD we're talking about. You understand? And given their history and everything like this, for decades, they're one of the most clannified ass police. Well, all the police, all the white police across the fucking country are the same. I'm not gonna make no distinctions. Not making no distinctions. There are no good ones. You understand? But I'm saying, I know my people also. And this just wouldn't have happened. So this was more lies. They put somebody in that crowd because it was costing police resources and be standing out there at this black man's land, and we really don't need this much memorializing of this black man, even though we're saying one thing, we really don't mean it, and that's why we sent all this police presence anyway, because we feel like if there's more than two of you gathered, it's dangerous to the rest of the world. You see, so there's so many things wrong with this. I can't. I can't. Something's not right about this, everybody. Period. The damn end. I said it. And don't give me this was just two brothers arguing, because what I know is, whoever you're going to tell me this Eric Holder person is, you can't live in the hood and you've shot this brother. Folks know you too. You see what I'm saying? Nah. Like, it has to add up. You understand what I'm telling you? Anyone believe that this brother would come back there and do this to this brother? I mind you that we still don't know, in quotations, we don't know who killed Tupac. We don't really care who killed Biggie. I don't. Because to me, like I say, Biggie was assassinated, or Tupac was assassinated. Biggie's fat ass was just shot. That's just how I feel about it. He wasn't the intellectual, or the intellectual promise that Tupac was. He just wasn't. His motives and his whole reason for existing was different than Tupac's. It was just all different. Like, he was shot down. Tupac was assassinated, but I cite the both of them still as I contrast it against this, because there's cameras, and Tupac was shot in on the Las Vegas Strip or one of them side streets or something. Cameras, everybody. And then on top of that, the shady circumstance under which Biggie was shot, the same type of circumstance, both of you with your record executive, and they're in the car and they don't get shot. Anomaly. Pattern. Conspiracy. 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 And so I say to you that what we don't care about nothing else but the other victims in this case. That's all we focus on now. That's all I'm focusing on. I want to hear statements from them. Because even in this article, they're telling us everything about everything and everything. Because what they say when they mentioned he was shot, they said that he was shot, and I think they just mentioned two others. But no names. What hospital do they go to? What condition are they in? You see what I'm saying? What's not being said? What's not being said? The chaos in the crowd was frightening. Quote, tonight was the final night in a while that I honestly felt scared on this job. ABC7 reporter and white bitch Veronica Miracle wrote in Twitter. Babies were screaming, people were shoving themselves under our ABC7 news van for cover while crying. People were stampeded because the police set off something or started something. You know, it's cr they do that shit. We've seen it a million times, everybody. And they tell you, oh, and what they always give you, they were throwing rocks and bottles and glass. Suddenly there's all this glass. You understand? Suddenly there's all this glass. Frankly, I don't know the last time I've seen another human being drinking out of a glass thing. If they weren't at a sit-down restaurant, there's just not all this glass. You understand? And you see kids with these backpacks, and even adults, and people of all ages. They have these plastic water bottles and plastic soda bottles and plastic, goddamn it, plastic. Don't give me glass. This was set off by the police. Understand this, because I listened to the report very, very intently, and they said that the whole area was shut down, like not just that street, like the area. I can't. In my mind, they said this dude was there. To me, it was go there, see if he's there. Went away, came back, boom, do the act and leave. If this is even the, even if this Eric Holder dude is the dude. You understand? We want these people that were shot there as well, and we want to see the video for ourselves. Nothing else. And so I make this affirmative statement. If we don't hear from the two other people that were shot and or see the video also, everything that every claim that I'm making is the gospel law on this. Period. We're not going to play footsies about this. We're not. You understand? And it's time that we stop softballing and being bitches when one of us is taken out by this enemy. I was so frustrated going back to this documentary I told you I was watching. This young this, this it wasn't just this sister, but she was just a standout, 'cause I could see her heart grow into it. And they had this thing where they went to the city council dinner. Well, this guy was being honored at some dinner. He was somebody that could give them progress on what they're seeking with these school searches. And they raised the $3,000 so that several of the students could go to this dinner and be there, so they could, at the right moment, they stand up and start protesting and tell them, this is some bullshit and this is what we, blah, 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 blah. Well, he ran interference on them, and when they said we paid to be here, so we're paid to be we already paid to be here, so then like we just ran up on the joint, so they couldn't throw them out. And they're like, okay, well, we'll just have dinner, and then the councilman will speak after. And while they were eating, he ghosted out on them. Well, at the end of it, when they're leaving the restaurant, this young sister is saying, she goes, I know we did a good thing, and I know we did the right thing, but somehow it still hurts. And I wish I could have just been there to hold that sister and say, because you got to fight violence with violence, sister. These people, we pussyfooting with their ass too fucking much. You understand? It's against human nature. They have laws in this country of assault, even. Somebody touches you, that's assault. And we're supposed to allow ourselves to be just murdered down and genocided all fucking day and night? And we're supposed to be peaceful? Nah, homie. And so we're raising another generation of those who think they got to put in all this time making signs and spending money and taking their time to march up and down streets chanting and shit, when there's a much faster goddamn it solution. So we want answers on this. We want answers. We want answers. And it's so hand, I mean, I can't, dude. I can't. I hate the fuck out this country. And I only ask that the divine rescues my people from it. and then destroy this bitch to fucking dust. That is my prayer. That is my prayer. How much can a people take? And they're used to us taking it. You know? Oh, they'll holler for a few minutes and they'll shut up and sit down. And our evil can continue. You know? This is what we're dealing with. But let this be the message we give to our children, everybody, the following. Let the following message be what we give to our children about this, brother. Show them the video of the crowds that gathered. Show them, tell them that their life needs to have mattered on the earth. That even if crowds don't gather for them, they will want to have gathered. Let their life be of meaning in existence to their people. To their people. Somebody else gets something out of it, that's bonus. We're not concerned about that. Show them that this brother went and did business in his own community to turn that black dollar over right where it originated. Let them know that he is an example of a life that mattered to more than just himself and his immediate family. That he's an example worthy of being imitated. You know, it's like Michael Jackson. Michael was and is the brightest star that shines in the universe. That brother, my God, I just watched a video the other day. It was nothing but like an hour or something or more. All it was Michael going to get awards for something, you know. And there was ones that we knew about, but there was a whole lot of them we didn't know about. We're showing up at places to get yet another humanitarian award. Yet another humanitarian award. Yet another humanitarian award. Yet another humanitarian award. Philanthropy and all these things. So we join this brother in that fraternity of black men whose life was snatched away from us by the enemy of our people, but whose light shined for us. And they meant it. They meant it. Tell them this is what they should be imitating. The principles of it. We don't need them to have their hair like Nipsey, and we don't need them to have a bunch of tattoos all over their face and body and all this, you know. That is a testimony of his full life. You see in these pictures, you see the graduation of from a boy to a man, really, because the tattoos represent the boyhood, I would suggest to you. Because grown men, we're not going out getting tattoos. Men don't do that. Boys do that. And as I tell you, you don't always come into manhood just because you're a certain age. You know, you could be 60 and you're still not a man. Still ain't. Still ain't. when I look at this brother, I see literally the physical graduation from boy to man. Because when I was selecting pictures to pull of him, I was mostly just trying to go with the most current of how he looked now. But this picture right here, you see there's no beard. You know, even the body language is more boyish. But here he's more resolute. The body posture is even representative of that, the facial expression and everything. And then he let his beard come in, and he has a very good, all the brothers looking at that beard, y'all know that's a very good quality beard right there. We all hate on it and want that beard. I certainly do, you know. And I think we can just look at that as a physical representation of boy to man, you know. And then his actions. In fact, one of the things that T.I. said was one of the things that was so hurting about the loss of him was because he was one of the few people in the business, like in their genre, so to speak, of hip hop, that he could really speak to on those higher frequencies. I know what he's talking about. Because I've said to you when I've talked about Tupac, one of the things that always hurt me for Tupac or frustrated me for him, or I felt his frustration of, is he was different than the people he was around. I've been there. I know what that is when you're a different light. You're a different light. And you're around people that they don't even have that calling. You're never gonna be able to elevate them to where you at. They just not there. And you have to subsist and exist in that. You can't have the conversations you want to have, you know, the things that really matter. You know, my father used to say to me, you know, of all my children, he used to say to me, of all my children, you're, because me and my father, we get on the phone and we would blow a phone to dust. Like we'd be on there for easily 6 hours. Easy. It was nothing. That's a regular conversation for us, you know. And he used to say to me, you know, you're the only one of my children that, you know, because there was a lot of things my dad could talk about with me that he just didn't feel like my other siblings. They weren't invested. They just weren't there, you know. They just aren't there. And so that's another example, you know. So I really related to what T.I. was saying. I know what that is. To be able, you know, you're in a sea of knuckleheads, basically, and you can't really find that person that you can land your heart on to, you know, your intellect and your thought process, your frequency, really, you know, to use his word again. I think that's the word to use. Like, can we vibe at the same frequency? You know, can we get there? And that's where this brother was at. And that's one of the things that T.I. expressed about, you know. And then we heard, we're finding out now, at least I am, about, you know, he had a larger vision for entrepreneurship as far as teaching and grooming others and, you know, people in the community and things like that. I mean, he was just on the right track. God bless him. 33. 33. 33. So his life is only a waste now for all of you under the sound of my voice if you don't communicate the message that I've articulated to you, to our children. Even if you're a total disaster, let's stop living according to what we came up through. We have to put a stamp on our children. Gotta put it on them. Put it on them. You see? We gotta do that, everybody. If you want something you never had before, you gotta do shit you never did. I say this all the time because it is the absolute 100% golden key to success. That's it. You know? I've seen a million books of the, you know, the keys to success and the 10 steps of success and success and success, and none of it. I'm over all of it. This simple phrase that I say all the time is the key to anything you want to do in life. Hear it again. If you want something you never had, you must do something you never did. This is the Jedi.